So first of all, thank you to all be here. So for some drinks and some science also. And so before to start, I would like to share with you a picture, which is basically the behind the scene of the story I will tell you today. So that's this picture here. So I don't know if you can see my arrow. So on the right. So basically here you see our great boss, Bassam Hassan, and so also my lab mate. So here, Gerrit Lineweber, and here, Sue Chetana. And so also what I hope is that at the end of this evening, you will see, I hope that you will see the fly from another view. So you will see that fruit flies are actually very great. And okay, so when I'm talking about flies, so I'm talking about this little fly that we call fruit fly or Drosophila melanogaster, and it's typically the fly that you find in your kitchen when you forgot a ripe fruit outside. So that's little flies that really recognize, you can really recognize it because of this red eye. And so this little fly, so even if we are different, this fly is very useful for us researchers to try to understand the basic and fundamental principle of biology, but also how our body works. And so here, even if we are different, so we definitely don't look like a fly, so we share a lot of things. We have a lot of things in common. So the first thing is that even though the genome of the fly is tinier than us, than ours, so we share 60% of similarities with these little fruit flies. We also have a lot of conserved biological mechanisms. And so you will see today that actually flies also have a nervous system and a brain. And the fly, as us, has their own individuality. And so here is just to show you how the brain of the fly looks like. So of course it's quite different from our brain. So here you can appreciate the size, so really tiny compared to the size of a human. They also have less neurons, but as us, they have neurons, and these neurons are basically the working unit of the brain. And so they are connecting between each other to send and also receive information and allow us to basically function, appreciate the environment, and coordinate ourselves. And so how does it look from a microscope? So here it's an example of a fly brain that you can see under a microscope. So what you can see is like it's a simple staining, so we can color the brain. And so you can see some structure here already appeared. So as a human brain, the fly brain also have different structure dedicated to different brain function. But also what's interesting that as the human brain, so the fly brain also have two sides, a left side and the right side. So as for the human that has a left and right hemisphere. And so what's very nice with a fly is that we have a lot of genetic tools. And so what we can do, so here in this picture, so we can genetically label, look, with fluorescent protein, a specific neuron population. So here as an example, you can see a neuron population in red, or for instance here, a single neuron here in green. So that's basically what you can see under your microscope. And so it's good to see color, but this is also useful to basically understand, for instance, how these neurons are connecting between each other in the brain. And so then you can really try to understand how the neural circuit is formed, is structured. But with this tool, we can also go even further. And so we can also try to understand how the brain can integrate a stimulus from the environment, but also how it can control our behavior. And on the other hand, what you can also do with these tools is to try to understand how do you build this brain? How do you build this complex neuronal structure and interaction? And so this by studying not the adult, but the brain development, and all that under a microscope. So for this first part of the talk, so I will first, I suggest we first focus on behavior. And so here for this story, so we are actually focusing on a specific type of behavior, which is stripe fixation. So somehow, so the little flies are really attracted by this black bar on top of a white background. So they will really get attracted. And so if, for instance, you put them into an arena, like here in this picture, so the fly, and so if you put two black stripes in both sides, the fly will start to walk in between. And so as I said, so we want to study this type of behavior. And so to study behavior, you need more than flies. So what you need to do is like within a population of fly, you can to observe, you need to observe each individual one by one. And so that's what we did basically in this situation. And so that what was really striking and interesting is that within this population, each fly would behave differently. So you would see some flies that would basically be really straightforward and precisely walk in between these two stripes. But you would see other flies that would be more adventurous and start to explore their environment. And so the first question I would like to ask you is that how would you explain the differences in behavior between individuals within the same population? So I don't know if you have any ideas of how it could be. So I can give the answer later too.
But Franzi is raising her hand.
Ah, I don't see. Okay, yeah.
I mean, an individual could move erratically or differently because maybe of mutation or like a disease or maybe environmental factors.
Mm-hmm.
I'm definitely not a fly scientist, but I'm just trying to think what would make me move weirdly. So
that's a good point. Actually, you gave two answers in once.
Yeah.
So basically, yes. So you said it. So you have actually the two main studied origin of this type of variability within a population is either because you have differences in your genome. So for instance, as you said, some mutation, or because you have these flies that have been exposed to different environments react differently and then will behave differently. But in laboratory, in our case, so we can actually control all these parameters to try to dissect the cause of this variation. So what we did is to basically put all this flying into the same genetic background and the same environment. So we basically remove these two variables. And still, we observe individual behavior. So each fly would still behave differently. So then the next question was like, okay, so we are talking about behavior. So what controls behavior? It's the brain. We say, okay, so let's go more into a bit more deeply and let's have a look at the brain structure of the fly. And so what we did, so here you have an example of the fly brain. And so what we did is basically now to focus on a population of neurons that is specifically involved in this stripe fixation behavior. So here on this schematic, you have an example of where are these neurons located. And so one first thing that is really interesting is that these neurons, this group of neurons, are actually present in both sides of the brain. So here, one example in blue here in the left, and one also population in the right side. So the same population, so two populations of the same type of neuron in both sides. And so what is also interesting in this type of neurons is that it's their structure. So basically, the neurons that are located in the left side will send some extension that will cross the brain and target the opposite side of the brain, and in a specific area which is involved in the visual area that basically process and receive information from visual information. And so what we did is like, and so here if you look on the red side, so in the red cell, so it's basically the same thing, so it's really like mirror. So what we did is like to look at the structure of this neuron specifically, but in the brain of each individual of this population that share the same genetic background and the same environmental background. And what was really interesting is that each fly has different structure, a structure that would be kind of similar, but with some variability and some variation. So you would see, for instance, some brains, so here that we call a brain that is asymmetric, where you would have differences in the number of neurons in the left and in the side, in the right side. So here you would have 3 neurons that target this visual area. And in the right side, you would have, for instance, 5 neurons. So an asymmetric structure. Some other fly from the same population, so here on the right, would have a brain when you would have the same number of neurons in both sides of the brain. And we call this structure symmetry, a symmetric brain. And so, yeah, so basically, so already at the structural level, we have some individual variation. And so what we did is just to look a bit more further and say, okay, so we have different structure. So does it correlate with the behavior? How does this structure impact the behavior of a fly? And so that's what we did. And so what we figured it out is that if a fly has a brain that is asymmetric, so more asymmetry you will have, more the fly will be really precise and walk in between the two stripes. While if you have a brain that is symmetric, so the same number of neurons in the both sides, so the fly will tend to be more adventurous and explore more the environment. So this basically tells you that within a population, the structural variation of the brain is actually the cause of the individual behavior of the fly in the population. So, yeah, so if you have any question, more, I try to slow down. But here, so from this experiment and this observation, especially the observation of an asymmetrical brain, so we can also get more information on how do you build this brain. So because here, if you focus on the asymmetric brain, so this brain has, so the both sides of the brain share the same genetic background because it's the same individual, but also have the same environment because, again, it's the same individual. So this suggests that there is something else that will create differences within the brain structure. And so the idea is that this might come from development, something else than genetic and the environment. And so this type of left and right asymmetry is not only specific to flies or fly brain, but we also do have this type of left and right asymmetry. So for instance, in our brain, we do have some asymmetry. We also have, like in our hands, so we do have different innervation in our left hand and also our right hand. Another example is basically the finger print of our hands that are basically different in both sides, but also is typically different between all individuals. And the next example I will show you is maybe, at least to me, the most striking one. So I don't know if you have an idea
Maheva.
Yeah, I come back.
Sorry for interrupting.
No.
I think it's a good point to give you a question from the audience.
Yes. Because,
as Nata wrote in the chat, just getting a thought, brain symmetry then is beyond the genetic and environmental background you controlled for. Could you elaborate?
So what do you mean beyond? So it's like, mainly, or because basically it's some part. So basically, I'm not saying that genetic is not involved or environment is not involved, but basically, then it's beyond. So basically, either asymmetry or symmetry arise from what we call stochastic developmental process. So and come from so how the brain develop. And so whether you end up symmetry, at least in the case of the specific neurons, whether you end up asymmetric or symmetric, it's just a matter of probability. Because for this neuron, so the way it works is that, so here, for instance, you have a pool of neurons, and during development, all these neurons are identical. And so the way it happens is that this neuron, at some point, will start to talk between each other and to compete to target or not this specific area. And so basically during this process, you cannot predict whether which neuron will target or not. So there is some part of randomness or some randomness in the process. And the thing that now, so I'm talking about one side, but we also have the other side, and the both sides basically work independently. So let's say you have the left side that suddenly create three neurons, and then the other side will have some chance to have either three neurons or five neurons. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that, so basically now if you talk about genetics, so in this process you have different, you also have like, it involves protein, and protein are encoded by genes. And so by having some mutation, for instance, you can increase or decrease the probability of an axon, for instance, to target. And so then you will increase, for instance, the range of phenotype or brain structure that you can have in a population. So somehow it's not like only in the symmetric brain, it's just a matter of probabilities of having the two sides similar and not different. So I don't know if I answer the question.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Snata. Oh, sorry. I was trying to unmute and somehow I couldn't reach you in voice, so I had to write in the chat. Yeah, that answers the question absolutely. I had no idea that it can be probabilistic. I was just like, I don't think I phrased the question correctly. I was just thinking like, you of course controlled for some factors, some genetic and environmental factors, mm-hmm. but this then it has a different pathway, right?
Yeah.
Like the brain symmetry, as you explained.
So basically, say it again. So it's a different pathway. What do you mean by pathway?
It's a different. I don't know exactly how to say it. Like the whole developmental process is different, or how is it like?
I see. So basically, exactly the same developmental process. Let's say during the phase. So the way to see the development. That you can see a kind of chain reaction. So you first have step A, and then so what you have out from the step A will feed the second step. And so basically just this outcome that basically the first step will say, okay, so first the cell need to communicate between each other. And then at some points, some will have like a factor I go for it, and the other one will say, okay, I stay where I am. And so, but right. You cannot predict. And then, so out of this, you will have the second step where the one that say, okay, I go will go, but basically, and the one that have the signal I stay will just stay. And so, and just the whether you are symmetric or asymmetric, it's just mm-hmm. an outcome of this step A and B. So with the same step A and B that you cannot predict, you will have either the final result, basically.
Right. Totally understood. Great.
Thank you for your questions, Nata.
And thank you.
Lisa, I have seen you have raised your hand. Do you also have a question?
Yeah, my question, I had a question, but it was resolved during her explaining.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Okay, so let's continue with Marilyn Monroe. Oh no.
Oh no, sorry.
So indeed, it's Marilyn Monroe. So actually, it's the two right side of Marilyn Monroe face. And here is basically the two left side of Marilyn Monroe. And so basically here is really an example to show that in our face, even if we think we are symmetric, actually we are not at all symmetric. So, for instance, we always have like one eye that is bigger than the other, or like the ear are also like sometimes different. So yeah, so that is basically to show you that even us are the both sides, we really have some subtle differences that are, yeah. So yeah, that was just to show that also as fly, we do have left and right asymmetry. And so here, I'm almost done actually, but it's also to just kind of summarize that one of the main messages that, so all these variations that we see are, so one big part of this variation is basically how does the brain develop. And so that's great. The question I had before, because then I explained basically this part of that is, this little step that you cannot basically fully predict the outcome that will generate different pattern or a structure in the brain. And this different structure of the brain will then have a direct consequence in our behavior or in the fly behavior. And I would say that if you have one thing to remember from this 20 minutes of today, is basically that the origin of our individuality is actually not only due to genetic differences or environmental differences, but also due to how the brain or how the full individual is developing to become an adult. So, yes, so that's it. So if you have any more questions, please don't hesitate to ask me.